Well, good morning and welcome to New City Fellowship. We are so glad to have you here with us. If you are joining us for the first time, we're really grateful to have you with us. And we hope that our service, our time together, Jesus's love would be made real to you this morning. So welcome to worship. Everything you need for the service will be displayed on your screen. But if you'd like a digital copy of our Rhythms of Grace, you can download it from our website at newcityfellowship.in. Let's now take the next few minutes in silence and use the reflections that hopefully will appear on the screen soon to warm our hearts and to prepare our hearts for worship. For those of you who've just joined in, welcome to worship. We're really grateful to have you with us. A brief thought as we enter into worship this morning. Recently, I was listening to a podcast on parenting, obviously for a friend who needed it, and I was helping him do that. And in that podcast, what they were discussing is how in this past 1 year, also, lots of kids have been regressing in their mental and emotional health. They gave many reasons, at least two of them which stood out to me was one, because they don't have the structure they need and the structure that they are used to, and because they don't have the presence of other adults and kids in their lives. And as we know, attachment is crucial and critical for the development of a child. And for one-year-olds, as our daughter is going to turn one soon, I was listening from that perspective. And one of the things they said is one of the main things, the best things for children is to have the presence of a loving caregiver, someone with them, looking at them, holding them. And that's really important for their development. And especially in this time, in the aftermath of a pandemic or through the pandemic even, one of the things that really is helpful for children, besides giving them structure, food, and clothing, is the presence of someone. Is to be with them, is to turn around, see them, to look them in the eye, to hold them as often as possible. And so this morning, Jesus wants us to slow down, to look us in the eye, to hold us, and to tell us that he is with us. He wants to offer us his loving presence to you and to me, to all of us. And so that's really what we're going to look at this morning, that in his presence, we find a satisfaction, fulfillment, and joy. That is the gift that we'll consider this morning. And the big question we want to ask is Jesus, is the gift of his presence enough for us? So with that said, let me invite you to our call to worship. Surely God is my salvation. I will trust and will not be afraid. For the Lord God is my strength and my song. He has become my salvation. Sing praises to the Lord, for he has done glorious things. Let this be known in all the earth. Shout aloud and sing for joy, people of God. For great in your midst is the Holy One of Israel. Let's continue our worship with songs of praise.
Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise him, for he is thy help and salvation. All ye who hear, now to his temple draw near. Join me in glad adoration. The Lord over all things so wondrously radiant, shelters the under his wings, a so gently sustainment. Hast thou not seen how thy desires have been granted in what he ordained? Praise to the Lord who doth prosper thy work and defend thee. Surely his goodness and mercy daily attend thee. Ponder anew what the Almighty can do, if with his love he befriend. The Lord, oh, let all that is in me adore him. All that had life and breath come now with praises before him. Let the amen sound from his people again. Gladly forever adore him. Let the amen. Let the amen sound from his people again, gladly forever adore him.
Let's pray. Our great Savior and King, we praise you this morning, for you are indeed the Almighty, who is the King of all creation, and over all things you wondrously reign, while gently sustaining them. We exalt you, for you are God alone. There is no other, never has been and never will be. You are the eternal King, the unseen one who never dies, the eternal Savior who has defeated death and has set us free. For your unending faithfulness, O Lord, revealed to us in Christ Jesus, and made present to us through your Holy Spirit, we praise you this morning. We praise you because it's your breath in our lungs.
Life, you are love, you bring life. give all, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you.
You give life.
You give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you. Oh, it's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. Pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you. Shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing.
Friends, it's when we encounter and experience the greatness of this God, the beauty of this God, that we discover the ugliness and the brokenness residing in our own hearts. So let's come to God, bringing our confessions of our sin and shame to Him, knowing that He is making all things new, and He intends to do that in our hearts this morning as well. Let's use this prayer of confession and come before our God. Holy God, we confess we are just like our first parents who coveted the forbidden fruit and your exalted wisdom and position. We are prone to be dissatisfied with our possessions, with our spouses, with our co-workers, with our friends, with our bodies, with our allotted circumstances in life. So we envy the circumstances of others, and we grumble at the good that they enjoy. Lord, we lack contentment. We need your grace in order that we might turn away from the idolatry of our covetous hearts. Renew us by the power of your gracious spirit and conform us to the righteous image of Christ. We pray this in the name of your Son. Amen. Let's take the next few moments in silence to bring our private and personal confession before God, hearing Jesus's words that whoever comes to me, I will not drive away. I will not reject. I will not cast away. So let's, in confidence, come to God in the silence of our own hearts. Friends, if you've truly confessed your sins, and if you've turned to Christ for in faith, would you hear these words of assurance from Jeremiah? These words are meant to assure us that our pardon in Christ is true and it's unchanging. This is a covenant I will make with the people of Israel after that time, declares the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people, for I will forgive their wickedness and will remember their sins no more. Friends, in Jesus Christ, we are forgiven and strengthened to live new lives of faith, obedience, and joy. And God's people respond, thanks be to God, amen. We have an opportunity to affirm our faith through the Westminster Larger Catechisms. As I read the question, you can respond together with the text below. What does every sin deserve at the hands of God? Every sin, even the least, being against the sovereignty, goodness, and holiness of God, and against his righteous law, deserves his wrath and curse, both in this life and in that which is to come, and cannot be expiated except by the blood of Christ. What does God require of us that we may escape his wrath and curse due to us because of our transgression of the law? To escape the wrath and curse of God due to us because of our transgression of the law, God requires of us repentance toward him, faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ, and the diligent use of the outward means by which Christ communicates to us the benefits of his mediation. Friends, now as we come to a time of offering, this is a time where we respond to the kindness and mercy that we have received from God. It is a time where we bring our hearts, our whole lives, and our financial gifts to him. This is a way where we say Jesus is enough for us. So let me invite you to worship God by bringing your gifts to him. You can give online, and you can also set aside this week's tithes and offerings and bring it to worship when we gather in person. But let's now celebrate the kindness of God by responding to him cheerfully.
The sands of time are sinking, the dawn of heaven breaks, the summer moon has sighed for the fair sweet morn away. Dark, dark had been the midnight, but day spring is at hand, and glory, glory dwelleth in Emmanuel's land. O Christ, he is the fountain, the deep, sweet well of love, the stream on earth that tasted more deep, I'll drink above. There to an ocean fullness, his mercy doth expand, and glory, glory dwelleth. But her dear bridegroom's face, I will not gaze at glory, but on my King of praise. Not at the crown he giveth, but on his pierced head. The Lamb is all the glory of Emmanuel's
I invite Sarah to make the announcements and prayer for the city.
Good morning, church. I'm so very sorry. I had an internet outage just at the moment I was supposed to speak. My apologies. So very sorry for that. I hope that it will be fine now. So good morning to everyone. A very good morning to you all. It's so wonderful to worship with each one of you. And at this time, I would like to ask the City Kids to please join the City Kids link and have fun. And also a very warm welcome to all those who have joined us today to worship. So glad to have you, and also a warm welcome to anyone who is visiting us for the very first time. And it's wonderful you could join. There is a short, we'd love to get to know you better. And I think there's something in chat that was just posted. If you could quickly fill out that form, it would help us to know you better and also know how to serve you in any way that we can. And as for the announcements, we have, today will be the last of our series in the Ten Commandments. Starting August, we will have a new sermon series, which is based on the life of Jacob. And please do join us as we see how his life is transformed and God is glorified in through it. Also, a quick note that there will be a resumption of in-person services starting the 8th of August. Please do keep our pastor, elders, leaders in prayer as they work through the logistics of all of that and as we all plan to return to worship shortly. And as you can see, their service teams are still in need of volunteers. So please do sign up if you feel you have a gift or an ability which you can bless the church with in any one of those areas. The details are given in your ROG as well, and also in the WhatsApp group. So please do sign up if you are able to. And there will be breakout rooms today right after our service. And we would ask you to please stay back and have a quick catch up in smaller groups, as that's always nice. So yes, that will be today as well. I think that is it for the announcements, and I would ask you to please join us now as we pray for our city. So let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning and we ask that you hear our prayers and answer them according to your will. We pray, Lord, that we might continue to be a community of believers, living, worshiping, and working together to accomplish your purposes. Father, we pray for those in the church who are sick, that you would heal them and restore them with renewed strength. We pray also that you will meet the needs of those who have suffered losses due to this pandemic and that you will provide for them. Lord, we pray for all our expectant mothers that you would strengthen them and keep them and also the babies that they are carrying. Lord, we praise you for the wedding this past week of Sneha and Nikhil, and we pray that you would, we thank you, Lord, for this blessing to them and to their families, Lord. Father, we pray for our city, even as the government is allowing the opening of institutions such as colleges and also places of worship, that these places would be able to implement these openings with wisdom. And Lord, that there would not be a significant rise in cases as these take place. We pray for us, especially as a church, that as we look forward to meeting together in person, that you would take away any hesitancy or trepidations or that we might have in doing so, and that we might just glory in a meeting with your community of believers, Lord, and glorifying you. Lord, we pray for those in our city who each day are providing and transporting essential commodities to meet our needs, that as they serve, that you will protect them. And Lord, now we also pray for the preaching of your word and the hearing of it as well. We lift up our pastor Rakshit to you as he brings the word to us. We pray that we might hear expectantly, that you would enlighten our understanding and quicken our hearts to hear what you have to say to us today. And we ask all these things in the precious name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And I will now request Joel to please read the scripture passage to us. Thank you.
Today's passage is from Exodus chapter 20, verses 1 through 17. And God spoke all these words, saying, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself a carved image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or serve them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children to the third and the fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing steadfast love to thousands of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless who takes his name in vain. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter, your male servant or your female servant, or your livestock or the sojourner who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house, you shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his male servant, or his female servant, or his ox, or his donkey, or anything that is your neighbor's.
All right, good morning, church. It's so good to worship Jesus together today. And today we'll be looking at the 10th commandment, which is the last of our 10 commandments, our Decalogue. This concludes our Law of Love sermon series. And today we look at the commandment which focuses on our desires. Before we go forward, I need to qualify, and I want you to keep these qualifications in mind. Desiring a good thing is not bad. That is not what this commandment is getting at. Nor is this commandment getting at desiring a good change, because desiring good things and desiring a good change is part of how God created humanity. Back in Genesis, even before our first parents fell, God said, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and bring God's dominion on earth. So desiring a good thing, desiring a change is okay. So that's not what this commandment is getting at. So with these qualifications in mind, what is this commandment getting at? If its focus is on a desire and on desires, what is this commandment getting at? And that's the answer we'll try and seek. That's the question we'll try and seek an answer to today. Before we go any forward, let's pray. Father, would you please open our hearts to receive the sermon as your timely message to each one of us this morning. Help us see Christ and delight in him as a result. In Jesus' name, amen. What is your disposition towards all the good gifts in your life? What is your fundamental attitude when you look at the good gifts in your life this morning? Is it one of, you know, I have a good life. I have a good and reasonable to well-paying job. I have good relationships. I have good friends. Yes, life has its challenges, and I've had the hard stuff happened to me as well. But overall, I have a life that's good. And you're one of those people that when you're asked, how are you doing today? Your response is better than I deserve. Is that you this morning? Or is your fundamental attitude more of, I need an upgraded life. What I have is not enough. I need a better home. I am dissatisfied with what I have. I need a spouse. I deserve a spouse, or that I deserve a better spouse. I deserve a better job. I deserve a better paying job. I deserve a better boss. that when you look at the things that you have in life, your general attitude and disposition is one of, I deserve better. I deserve an upgraded life. What then is this commandment getting at? It's precisely that. It is firstly, a restless desire for another's possessions, because our functional belief as we go about in this life is that God is holding out on us. It's a restless desire for another's belongings, but it's also a restless dissatisfaction with our own belongings, because we think God has given us the cheaper stuff of life. The reason why our world sells and so much of our advertisements are targeted at this fundamental human conviction that we deserve better is because we have a restless dissatisfaction with what we have, because we actually think God has given us the cheaper stuff of life, and a restless desire for things we don't have, because the better stuff is out there and not here. And that is exactly what this commandment is getting at. This commandment gets to the root cause that makes violating all the other 9 commandments possible, the heart. If you notice all the other 9 commandments, the focus of the commandments is on the externalities. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. You should not dishonor your parents. Do not steal, do not lie, do not commit adultery. It focuses on the externalities. But if you have paid any attention to the preaching of the other 9 commandments, you'd have noticed that the preachers focus on the heart. And the reason is because the 10th commandment colors how the other 9 commandments are supposed to be looked at. That it focuses on the heart, more pointedly on the heart's lust. And that's the first thing we'll look at, the mechanics of lust. Where do you see the word lust, Rakshit, you ask? Because, you know, lust is often associated with sexual sin and temptation, right? But notice how this passage, this commandment, uses the word covet. Let's focus on the word covet, and I'll explain why I use the word lust. When we read the word covet, we usually think of greed, right? That's what we think of it as. But notice how the Bible uses the word here. It says, do not covet your neighbor's house. So don't be envious. And envy is at the heart of theft. And so you end up violating the commandment that says, do not steal. The 10th commandment says, do not covet your neighbor's wife. So when that happens, you've lusted after another person's spouse, another's wife. You've committed adultery in your heart. In fact, this commandment could be traced at the root of the violations of all the other 9 commandments, as I've already said. So the word covet is far bigger than just greed. If we take the 10th commandment, we are seen to break the whole law, because the 10th commandment acts like an X-ray to our hearts, to our spiritual condition, and the lens through which we understand the other 9. So coveting is actually the lens through which you look at all the other 9 commandments, and we will find ourselves to be breaking the commandments. You see, the word covet there is sort of translated as lust in the New Testament. For example, the Greek word epithumia, desire, for it says when you desire, that word there is really lust. You can lust after good things. You can covet the good things, right? When God says earnestly desire the higher gifts, It's the same language that's being used. But overall, the word lust is used negatively in scripture. And it's really the same word the same word is translated as lust. The mechanics of lust is quite complex. It's multi-layered. Imagine a car engine, right? It takes many different parts and components to make up that one single engine. It has many parts to it. And we'll look at just what those parts are. There are seven parts to any sin. Seven parts to any sin. If you had not heard that, well, welcome. This is sort of a training for and a boot camp for how sin works and all the different parts that make up sin. At the root level, at the heart level, at the deepest core level is lust. It is the internal rumblings and motions towards all that the heart regards as good. So before the fall, our first parents, and if we had not fallen with like they did, our heart's core desire and lust will always be for that which is good, and that's God. But instead, after the fall, the basic motion of the heart is to look at everything other than God, including the good gifts that he gives, and often even the wrong things of life, as the greatest good. The lust is that which is the basic motion of the human self towards that which it regards as good. So when lust ends up desiring the wrong things or the good gifts more than God, it ends up sinning already. Lust becomes sinful when it does not desire God as the greatest thing to be desired. As a result, what happens is when you start desiring the wrong thing, the basic motion of the heart ends up desiring the wrong thing or the good thing more than God. The first thought that comes is to have that thing, which is not God, or regards the wrong thing or the good thing as God. That first thought in itself is sinful because it has come out of a sinful lust. That's the second component to sin. But the third component is this: there is a settled thinking. You may have heard that everything that crosses your mind, even if it's bad, is not sinful. That's actually not what the Bible teaches. Sinful thoughts, even when they're not dwelt on, they're still sinful because they arise out of a sinful lust, the basic motion towards that which the self regards as the greatest good. And so because it's desiring the wrong thing and regarding the wrong thing or a good thing as God or be greater than God, the first thought that wants it is in itself sinful. And that's a second component. But the third component is when you start settling on that thought and you start developing a logic for why actually that thing is more desirable than God himself. That settled thinking is a sin too. And then you have the aspect of feelings. The first feeling that comes with regarding that thing as desirable. You've rationalized it now with your settled thinking. That thing could be good. And now your emotions are involved. Your feeling starts, your first feeling says, that's desirable more than God. And then you start dwelling on your feelings. And it develops into settled, growing feelings of desiring and wanting and feeling for and craving for the wrong thing. So now you have the lust that gives rise to sinful lust that has given rise to the first sinful thought that develops into settled sinful thinking that arouses our first sinful feeling that evolves into settled and growing sinful feelings that then together our settled thinking and settled feelings, growing feelings, direct our will to start wanting it more and more. It directs our will to actually have it, to possess it, to gain it. And that's when the will is engaged, it becomes an action. Those are the mechanics of how lust works. This whole engine is lust in itself. Because, like, for example, I don't know if this is going to work. Let's try it out. If you were to add salt in the sambar, and you added vegetables and dal and whatever you add in it, there is salt in itself. But the sambar is salty. The vegetables have salt. The dal now has salt. So the whole thing is salty, but then there is salt, right? Similarly, the whole engine is lust, but then there is lust in its core. So the mechanics of sin or lust is comprised of these six or seven things. There is the basic human sinful, the basic direction of the self, motion of the self toward that which is not good, that is lust. And then it develops into the first thought, and then settled thinking, first feeling, settled and growing feelings, and then consent of the will, which then evolves into action. Let's see how this works out in our first parents' sin, shall we? Let's take Adam and Eve. They're in the Garden of Eden. God says, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth. This whole earth is yours. But do not eat of this of the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. But then you have Satan, who offers a counter narrative. And he says, God is holding out on you. This is the good stuff right here. I mean, other stuff, I know you have the whole earth and all of that, but this is the real good stuff. He's giving you the cheaper stuff of life. The real good stuff is in the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. So Adam and Eve, they look at it. It looks good. There's a rationalizing that happens when they listen to Satan. The first thinking, and then the settled thinking. They listen to his narrative. They have a conversation with him about it as to how God is really not all that great and good. And then they start desiring it. Looks good. The fruit looks good. They start desiring it. And then the will acts on it. There's a consent of the will to the thinking and the feelings. Eve plucks it out of the tree. And she acts on her basic human motion that's driven away from God already and bites into that fruit. And Adam likewise takes that fruit and sins as well. We see this happening throughout scripture, where God says no, because it's for our good. Satan and our flesh says yes, because the basic motion of the human self, because we are children of Adam and Eve after the fall, is that we lust after things we shouldn't. Desiring a good thing above God, or desiring a wrong thing, like God has said to Adam and Eve, this is how lust works. The world sells all kinds of stuff to us, good things, but that says you are incomplete because you don't have this stuff. You have the cheaper stuff of life because the real good stuff is out there. What does this do to us? If this is how lust works, if these are the mechanics of lust, what are the effects of lust? And that's what we look at real quick. What does sinful lust do to us? Well, it brings about a sense of disenchantment of the good. We are not drawn to that which is truly good and beautiful. That's what sinful lust does. But then in our hearts, there's a sense of general restlessness. In my thinking about this, there are at least four things that I think sinful lust does to our hearts. Firstly, there's an insecurity about ourselves.
Because our self-worth is defined by what we have and what we don't have in comparison to others or in comparison to what's on sale out there, we feel insecure about our lives. We feel insecure about ourselves. Our self-worth is really challenged, and there's a restlessness about it. This constant desire to get that worth reinforced by getting all that stuff out there. We don't like feeling insecure, so to gain security, a restlessness about it. Secondly, that restlessness looks like ingratitude for what we have. We are completely oblivious to the good stuff that we do have in the present, because we are convinced that the good stuff is out there. What we have is really the cheaper stuff of life. A restless craving for looking for what's on sale out there. Constantly scrolling down on Flipkart and Amazon. Constantly looking at Urban Ladder and Pepperfry. Or constantly looking at the new car that Toyota or Volkswagen is selling. Because the real good stuff is out there. There's a general ingratitude about what we have. Thirdly, I think the restlessness of sinful lust looks a lot like anxiety. We are anxious, a FOMO, a fear of missing out, that I have to work hard at gaining that thing out there. There's an anxiety. We go about feeling anxious. There's constant rumblings within the spirit. There's never a sense of calm inside us. And then there is a general fear that what we do have, even though we are ungrateful for it, that what we do have is at least the cheap stuff. But still, I'm afraid that I might lose that. That I might end up losing the stuff that I do have. So restlessness of the sinful lust looks a lot like insecurity, ingratitude, anxiety, and fear. So let me take an example. Let's say, you know, I have an item, right? And let's say we were having a high school reunion happening next week. If one of my school friends showed up to my high school reunion in a BMW and I felt insecure about my item, my anxiety is already peaking about going to that reunion. I've thought about whether or not I should go like a million times already. And then against all of those feelings and restless feelings, I have decided to go. But because I feel so insecure about my self-worth, because really my worth is if I had a BMW at that point. My worth is if I owned a house and not paying for rent. Like that guy. I will be avoiding that guy constantly, right? But you may have done this too, where you have avoided that guy in the room because you felt so insecure around that person. So what does that do to me in my relationship to that person? I avoid that person. I do not have the mind space because of my insecurity, ingratitude, anxiety, and fear. I do not have the mind space to think that this is a divinely appointed opportunity for me to get to know what's been going on in this person's life all these years. I do not have the mind space for that. Instead of rejoicing in the God who gives good gifts to those who worship him and those who don't worship him, instead of rejoicing in the goodness of God towards all of humanity like that, because he sends rain upon the just and the unjust, it saps all capacity of love for my neighbor. You see, sinful lust makes me disable and unable to love my neighbor. And imagine if this person were literally my next door neighbor, man, I would have thought about if I gave into my sinful lust and did not engage with it, and I constantly lived in insecurity, ingratitude, anxiety, and fear, I would probably move, right? Because our heart is constantly looking at how to avoid this person. Because I've given so much room for my lust, this basic desire, this basic motion towards that which is not God, and regard the stuff of this life as God's, I find not only the good gifts that I have disappointing, I actually end up finding God disappointing. I find him to be a failure, right? Because my sinful thinking can become, in that moment, what's the point of worshiping the true God if he can't give me better stuff than my neighbor? If this God is really true and he owns all of heaven and earth, what's the point of worshiping him? So the real problem in all of this, my dear friends, when it comes to the 10th commandment and our sinful lusts, is that we find God disappointing and disenchanting. And only when our hearts, our basic lusts, our basic human desire, our basic motion of self is drawn back out to God, because right now it's bent towards self, it's only then will we find true rest for ourselves. Only when we find God truly most enchanting and worthy of all of our heart's affection and mind's attention will we be able to actually rest and not covet. There is the only power in finding God to be the most enchanting good for our hearts. Do we find the power to kill sinful lusts? So we've looked at the mechanics of lust. We've looked at the effects of sinful lust. What then is the alternative? What else is the commandment getting at? What is a positive injunction in this commandment? It is to find contentment, true rest for ourselves. What is contentment? The 17th century pastor Jeremiah Burroughs defines contentment as that sweet, inward, quiet, gracious frame of spirit, which freely submits and delights in God's wise and fatherly disposal in every condition. Sinful lust or covetousness is a restless ingratitude towards one's own station in life and a restless craving after others' station in life marked by disappointment in God. In contrast, contentment is a complete quiet and gracious frame of spirit which delights in God and submits to God's fatherly goodness in every station in life. And that's what we look at in the third point, the enchantment of contentment, the enchantment of contentment. The Apostle Paul in 1 Timothy 6, in verse 6, he says this, "But godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into the world, and we cannot take anything out of the world. But if we have food and clothing, with these, we will be content." And I want to highlight two things before we wrap up the sermon for this morning. In elaborating on the third point, the enchantment of contentment. There are two things that I think the Apostle Paul is saying here that'll help us enjoy God, which is the only source of power to obey the 10th commandment. Firstly, that we brought nothing into this world and we will take nothing. There's an American expression that says, you'll never see a hearse pulling a U-Haul. To make it more contemporary and relevant to us, you'll never see a St. Peter's hearse directing a porter's tempo. You'll never see a St. Peter surge directing a quarter tempo. All of us, all of humanity, the richest of the rich and the poorest of the poor, will leave behind all the riches and all the poverty here on earth when we die. No one's taking any stuff from here. Naked we came and naked we will die. Dust to dust, ashes to ashes. So the only riches that'll count then is how you spent all what you had during your earthly life to invest in contentment in God, to enjoy him and all his gifts. That's the only thing that's going to matter. A St. Peter's hearse will never direct a porter tempo. But the second thing the Apostle Paul gets at is the question, you want gain? Do you want to reap rewards? Do you want a good life? Invest in contentment. Isn't that so countercultural to us? Godliness with contentment is great gain, not investments, not a huge savings account, not a big house. None of those things is the great gain. But godliness with contentment is great gain. Look at what you have and look at the God who gave it to you. In 2015, Dan Price, he's the CEO of Gravity Payments. He slashed his salary from $1 million to like $70,000 a year so his employees could have a raise. A few years later, he announced that his employees would make a minimum of what he was making at that point, $70,000 a year, which was a huge jump for most of his employees. The consequence of this was that it had a tremendous impact during the lockdown, during the pandemic last year. There were a few employees who were not earning as much or who were at the risk of losing that $70,000 minimum. So what happened was because they saw Dan Price model it, a few employees took a voluntary salary reduction so that those who were less advantaged than themselves could benefit from it and that their salaries won't be cut. A leader's volunteering to disadvantage himself for the advantage of others has a tremendous impact on his followers. And we have a grander motion of this, a grander illustration of this in the true story of the God who became man, Jesus Christ. Jesus's first motion, his first impulse of his heart was not towards self, was to do the Father's will, which was to rescue sinners. During his earthly ministry, when he came down from heaven, he came as a poor servant. He saw the riches of the Roman Empire, which he gave to them, that he came into. The God who gave riches to the richest of human empires in human history. He came down poor. The creator of heaven and earth came in human form and he did not have a pillow to rest his head. He didn't have riches the world could speak of. In fact, when faced with temptation with Satan, one of the temptations that Satan used was that he would give all the kingdoms and the riches of this world if Jesus would only worship Satan. But because Jesus's basic motion of his self was not towards himself, but towards the Father to do that which pleased him, to the point that he actually said, his functional belief was that he came to do the will of his Father in heaven is his bread. I mean, that's how much he wanted to do that which pleased the Father. He relegated all of his rights as the Son of God. He became poor so that sinners like ourselves who constantly violate the 10th commandment, who constantly are ungrateful for what we have, because we actually think God is keeping the good stuff out there. He's not given it to us. God has given us the cheap stuff to us and the good stuff to those out there. To such sinners, he says, come to me. You are so restless, he says. This restlessness is giving and producing in you a sense of insecurity. It's challenging your self-worth. It's giving you a lot of anxiety and fear. And to such sinners, Jesus says, come to me and I will give you rest. He did not regard the stuff of this life worth possessing over contentment with the Father, so that all who are disenchanted with the true God, the greatest good in all of heaven and earth, that they might find true delight and satisfaction in God alone. Jesus promised a kingdom. He knew his functional belief was that a St. Peter's hearse will not direct a porter temple. He knew when he came down on earth that he will return to dust as far as his humanity is concerned. He came down so he can die for sinners. This Jesus, he looked forward to a kingdom that he would receive from his Father upon his resurrection. And he found the glories of that kingdom and primarily the presence of his Father far more enchanting than the best stuff in this world that disenchants us from that eternal kingdom. To all of us, this Jesus says, come. In me, you will find true delight, true rest, true contentment, and the power to kill covetousness, the power to kill sinful lusts. Let me make a couple of words of application before I close. Charles Simeon once said, enjoy everything in God and enjoy God in everything. Enjoy everything in God and enjoy God in everything. With what you have been given, the good and the bad, ask the Spirit of Christ to teach you to invest heavily in contentment. Because there is truly so much gain in investing in contentment. Ask him to teach you to enjoy Christ as you enjoy the good things that he gives. Secondly, if you are desiring a change in life, a good change, that's okay. But examine your heart. Given how much our culture accommodates and even celebrates sinful lust and covetousness, let us be diligent in prayer, seeking not our kingdom, not advancing our own kingdom, but advancing Christ's kingdom. Follow the one who said, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And see if this change that you are desiring would use all that we are to advance Christ's kingdom on earth and our satisfaction and contentment in Jesus alone. As a 16th century Presbyterian pastor, Alexander Gross said, and this was in one of our reflections, when Christ reveals himself, there is satisfaction in the slenderest portion. And without Christ, there is emptiness in the greatest fullness. With Christ, even the mere morsel of bread will be enough. But without him, even if you were the emperor of the greatest kingdom on earth, you will find everything utterly dissatisfying. Come to Jesus. Be satisfied in him. Repent of your dissatisfaction of him. And find in him true delight and true contentment and rest for your soul. Let's pray. Father, your word says godliness with contentment is great gain. Would you teach us to seek Christ's kingdom and invest heavily in our soul's contentment with you? In Jesus' name, amen.
Church, in response to the preaching of God's word, could I invite us to sing this last song, knowing that our greatest contentment is only found in Christ.
Abishua, for leading us in song today. And I don't do this often, but I want to thank all the people who make our services possible online. To serve online is no small thing, and to serve with constant a fear of losing internet connectivity is another thing. So I really appreciate all those who serve to make our online services possible. Right after the benediction, we'll break into breakout rooms for fellowship. And so please stick around. Receive now the Lord's benediction from 1 Thessalonians 5. Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ.
He who calls you is faithful. He will surely do it. And God's people respond, thanks be to God. Amen. Thank you, friends. We will now break into our different rooms. So.